I got in touch with 5 of the most prominent voices in machine learning. I'm talking about heavy, heavy hitters. I asked them one simple question. What are the most common mistakes you see people making when they start in machine learning? And they answered. Let's hear them out. My first two messages went to François Chollet, the creator of Keras, and Soumith Chintala, one of the co-authors of PyTorch. By far, they're two of the most respected machine learning scientists out there. Now, Chintala got back to me right away, and the first mistake he mentioned is about people that think that reading books and going through courses is enough to become good at machine learning. I have plenty of books. Now, I have not read them all, but I've read a fair bit, and I can tell you with absolute certainty, nothing replaces practice. So that's our first lesson. Books are relevant, but they are just one piece of a bigger puzzle. You gotta do the thing. So whenever I learn something new, and exciting, the first thing I want to do is find a problem so I can go and apply what I just learned. And that's cool until it isn't. Have you heard the saying, if all you have is a hammer, everything looks like a nail? That's the essence of Chintala's second point. Newcomers focus too much on deep learning, even when there are better solutions to solve the problem. Our second lesson is about awareness. Every tool has limitations. There's no free lunch and there are no silver bullets. I've got Chollet's answer here, and his first observation is very insightful, but I'm gonna leave that to the end of this video. In the meantime, I happen to know one of the only quadruple Kaggle grandmasters in the world. So I reached out, and boy, I loved his answer. A huge mistake people make is trying to get good at programming and statistics before going full throttle into machine learning. Listen, yes, programming is important. Statistics, probabilities, there are many different subjects that help. But if you're creating this artificially sequential process where you cannot do machine learning unless you finish everything else, you're making a huge mistake. I realize there are many different ways to learn, but the people I usually see making constant progress, they use a short learning cycle, something that looks like this. They start by building, gather feedback from the experience, learn whatever they don't know, and immediately get back into building more things. That's our lesson. I'm a TensorFlow fan. That's the one that I use the most. And if you are like me and have ever watched videos about TensorFlow, then you know Laurence. He's an AI lead at Google and a best-selling author. When I first messaged him, he was on vacation, but a week later he got back to me, and his first point was about imposter syndrome. More specifically, letting imposter syndrome become a problem for you. So imposter syndrome is something that it happens to most of us. I've met incredibly smart people, and they're usually very good at something, but incredibly insecure as soon as they get out of their comfort zone. And that's fine. The lesson here is simple. Don't let this feeling stop you. Machine learning is difficult, but it's doable. And every single day, many people are studying and they're contributing. Don't give up without trying first. Here is Laurence's second point. Thinking that your ability is measured by your history, particularly your academic one. Hey, I get it. If you search for machine learning jobs, you'll find many positions that require a PhD or a master's degree. I talk to many people that are completely heartbroken because of this. Here's the good news. Over the last couple of years, we've made a ton of progress in this front. Companies are starting to realize that you don't need an advanced degree in order to be effective at your job and be successful at it. Lauren says, I know many folks who are super successful who don't even have a bachelor's degree. Yeah, me too. This is one of my favorite machine learning books. And of course, I reached out to Sebastian, the author, and the first mistake he mentioned was related to evaluating models. By the way, François Chollet had very similar comments. They both pointed out that people use metrics without context. They have data leaks and use features they cannot collect in practice. In short, newcomers struggle interpreting and evaluating machine learning models. Look, I built this example some time ago. It uses contrastive learning to solve a popular exercise. And my solution is 92% accurate. That sounds great, but there is a small problem with it. I can easily get a much better accuracy with a simpler solution. A metric without context means very little. Here is the second mistake that Sebastian mentions.
People tend to spend too much time tuning hyperparameters and trying different models instead of improving the performance through better data.
I've discussed this before. Better data is better than better models. The lesson here is to understand how important is the data you have to build a good model. You can usually get farther by focusing your time in improving your data instead of micro-optimizing your model. Now, in case you don't know, this is one of the best deep learning books in the market, period. Chollet wrote it, but most important, he created Keras, the library at the heart of TensorFlow. So of course I reached out to him, and he sent me one of the most insightful answers I got. The most common beginner mistake is to anthropomorphize what machine learning models are doing.
Anthropomorphize.
In other words, people attribute human characteristics to machine learning models. And that's a very slippery slope that will lead to dangerous conclusions. Since humans use ability X to perform Y and model does Y, it must be through ability X. That's a trap. Thinking that models will perform similarly to a human under the same circumstances, or even that models will make the same type of mistakes that humans would, it's a problem that will lead to poor decisions. There's nothing better than talking to people, listening to them, learning from their experiences. And this is not the only time I've done it. Here is a video with 5 practical lessons from talking to the authors of one of my favorite books. So take a look at it, go nuts, build something cool, and I'll see you in the next one.